So what is rationalism? The title of this talk assumes that I will give a definition of philosophical worldview of rationalism. Actually, in philosophy, definitions are permanently discussed. So there is no such thing as totally accepted definition of something. All definitions are redefined, changed, discussed, clashed between different schools, etc. So I will show with you my definition of philosophical rationalism, and I will tell you my reasons for that, why it is important, etc. And then it would be up to you to judge, is this definition good or maybe totally useless and completely stupid. So it's totally up to you. But before, let me remind you that we have our website, Fermi Society of Philosophy, wordpress.com, and we put there presentations and videos. Did you turn on video? No? Okay, so for those speakers who wish to suggest some presentation to our website or would appreciate making video, we are doing video, and then we are putting and uploading both presentations and videos for those speakers again who like it to our website there. And you may find for 5 years there are a lot of videos and a lot of presentations there, not only mine. I think mine is about 50% or so. But I'd like to make it less, this number of my presentation, more from other people. Philosophy Society@fnal.gov, it's our list, mail list, for those of you who want to be signed there, please. Either go to listserv, or send me email, Burov@fnal.gov, and I will put your name at this Philosophy Society@fnal.gov for you to be updated. And also we have a meetup page for those people who are outside to know that we do exist and come join us here, and would be very appreciated. So this is just general information. And now I'm starting with my rationalism talk, and I will start it with a story. I think a good manner to start the talk is to start it with a story, or with some banality. I like actually the two modes of starting the talk, either banality or next to banality statement or from the story. The story happened in Plato Academy, and Plato, it is his years of life, 429-348, in Athens, Athenian aristocrat, and maybe one of the biggest philosopher of all time, Whitehead, English mathematician and also philosopher of last century, said that the entire European philosophical tradition can be safely considered as a sequence of footnotes to Plato dialogues. And I think he was right. My personal opinion is that it's there is a little bit of exaggeration, but not much.
Well, what about Socrates? At the end of the day, don't forget Plato was actually a student of Socrates, and also he was
a student of Archytas, this Pythagorean. Plato wrote a lot of dialogues, and in his dialogues he never expressed any idea from himself. All the ideas expressed in his dialogues are from some other people of Athens, or maybe strangers, travelers from other cities, but nothing from Plato himself. And a lot, of course, maybe the main hero of Plato dialogues is Socrates, and we know about Socrates mostly from Plato dialogues. Socrates, contrary to Plato, wrote nothing. He preferred to speak. So there is a sort of complementarity relation between Socrates and Plato. Socrates appears a lot in Plato dialogues as a hero, speaking a lot of wisdom.
Socrates gave us the most important definition in philosophy, which is, I know that I know nothing, or I know I don't know.
We will discuss it maybe later. This is an important part of rationalism, but only part of it. Okay, so that's about Plato. Plato organized academy. I don't know. Plato organized academy in Athens, and academy existed for nine centuries, about. And it was the most long living educational organization in ancient world. And then it resurrected in the medieval time as universities of Europe. And then a lot of academies, Academy of Florence, Academy, and many national academies later, etc., etc. So Plato. And Plato had some very bright students in his academy. One of these students was Eudoxus. Eudoxus from Ionian city of Cnidos. And Eudoxus was one of the great early mathematicians, Eudoxus. And he contributed a lot to what later Euclid collected in his Elements. So Eudoxus was one of the great contributors. Although in time of Euclid, Eudoxus was not alive anymore, most likely. But historians of mathematicians are saying that Eudoxus' contribution to Element of Euclid is very important. Eudoxus had two great teachers, Plato and Archytas. Archytas was a Pythagorean of either second or third generation in south of Italy, where Pythagorean schools were blooming at that time, maybe not already blooming at Pythagoras' time, but still existed. And Eudoxus traveled to south of Italy, to Croton, I think, the city of Croton, and he took lessons from Archytas. And Plato also took lessons from Archytas. So they had a common teacher, and also Plato was a teacher of Eudoxus. Okay, this is a little bit of history. And Plato, seeing clearly mathematical talents in Eudoxus, asked him a question. And this is the key core of my story. The question is, we know this question from much later author Simplicius, who lived at the late antiquity. And, from Simplicius, that's what we know the question which Plato asked Eudoxus. But you see how important was the question. After almost 1,000 years, it was still kept and repeated, although Plato never wrote this. The question is, Plato to Eudoxus, by the assumption of what uniform and orderly motions can the apparent motions of the planets be accounted for? It's a little bit long. This is direct translation from Simplicius. How Simplicius repeats this. But if let me a little bit make it compact. By assumption of what fundamental principle the apparent motions of the planets be accounted for, be described for? What could be this fundamental principle which will allow us to describe this strange wandering of planets, semi-chaotic or seemingly chaotic planets. The very word planet in Greek means that wandering body, the body which moving, some strange trajectory, some stray body on the sky, contrary to stars. Stars showing very regular motion, associated, of course, with the rotation of the Earth, but at that time, it was not known yet, was not accepted yet. But anyhow, stars showed very, very clear circular motion by the same radius, by the same circumference. But planets were stray bodies. And Plato asked this question, what can be this fundamental principle which would allow us to describe this very strange motion? And this, I think, this question is paradigmatic, I would say. And this question already implies what I call rationalism. So put yourself in the shoes, not of contemporary people who used to think that everything in one or another day can be explained by one or another law of nature. Put yourself in the shoes of these ancient people who really did not know even a single law of nature. And what they knew about nature, they knew something empirical. That, well, after summer it will be autumn, etc. So the length of the year, some calendar affairs, they knew this. They knew how to use how to lead agriculture, etc. So many practical things. But they had no idea about these shining dots at the sky, what they are. Planets and stars would be different only by character of motion. Why do you dare to think that you are able to find clear, simple, fundamental principle which we which will describe this strange object in the sky just by this principle and catch them all? This is actually a very strange belief. But this was the belief of Plato, which not Plato invented, actually. Plato inherited this belief. And so there is a certain principle which what is complicated and maybe chaotic, but then if we will look on the observation which seems to us complicated and chaotic, this principle will allow us to see it not chaotic, not complicated, but realization of some simple principle. So we are able to understand this strange object about on the sky, which I either in infinity or extremely far from, we even do not know how far they are. We cannot touch them. We know only the strange motion. What they are? Maybe some demons are playing some strange game. Maybe some demons are trying to fool each other. Who knows what it is? Put yourself in the shoes of ancient people. And Plato still believed that no, there is a simple, clear, understandable mathematics behind of this. This was the belief of Plato. And based on this belief, he asked the question to his student, Eudoxus, try to find this principle. Find this principle. And Eudoxus actually spent a lot of time following this problem which his professor set for him, and he suggested this system. He suggested this system based on circular rotations. So it was heliocentric system. Heliocentric system where every planet actually followed some motion which was a superposition of rotation around several spheres which axis looked at different directions and which periods were not comparable. So he found this fitting formula, fitting algorithm which allowed him to suggest an algorithm how you can calculate the position of the planets in the star just based on these spheres. Well, nobody knows. We do not know was Plato happy about this solution of his student or not. Maybe he wanted something more elegant, less man-made, because there are many spheres and this angles between sort of 20 something spheres and for planets, and the angles were some strange angles, some different periods of rotations for these spheres. Well, it was the first realization what we call Fourier series. This is expansion of arbitrary function over basis of periodical function. That's what it was. It was the earliest predecessor of Fourier series. That's what Eudoxus invented, actually. And then later, this Eudoxian way of description of planetary motion on the sky was improved by Callippus, another mathematician of ancient world, about several hundred years later, and then eventually was represented by Ptolemy. So Ptolemy's system was a result of long-term efforts of astronomers and mathematicians of ancient world to represent as best as possible disagreement with observations, of course. This was the first requirement. It should agree with observation, and description should be as simple as possible. But they were forced to make again agreement with observation to increase number of spheres. In Ptolemy's system, number of spheres was 57 for all the planets. So every planet followed several spheres, and this and spheres were spheres rotating around the spheres, as he called them. This word, how he called them?
Epicycle?
Yes, epicycles. And epicycles and difference. Epicycles and difference, so he introduced rather complicated system. And then this system, probably Plato, I guess, would not be happy with this system because it was too complicated and did not show a clear shining of brilliant mind behind this. It was rather complicated machine. And what is the meaning of this machine? Why it is so complicated? The question was not answered. It was very strange. very strange Fourier series with 57 terms with some arbitrary or semi-arbitrary frequencies and then rotations or angles between these spheres. Okay, so that was, but it was very good from the point of view of agreement with observation. At time of Copernicus, which is 20 centuries later compared to Ptolemy and much more centuries later than Eudoxus, it still worked perfectly. The Ptolemaic system was in very good agreement, better than error bars of astronomers at that time, agreement with observations, and people, practical people who cared about this system of description of planets were absolutely happy. Who were these practical people, by the way? Any guess about this? Who were practical people who cared about agreement of this planetary description with real motion of planets?
Sailors?
No, sailors used stars. The planets were too complicated for sailors. Not sailors, but astrologers. Practical people who actually were taught to how to compute in the schools, how to compute the position of the star, say when your grandfather was born, or when your son is going to get married, and the girl, how to compare the horoscopes, etc. Planets are very important for that matter. So they were taught. So astrologers were real professionals on Ptolemy's system. And of course for church calendar sometimes it matters, but this I am not quite sure. Maybe Leo later will comment this. Hi Leo, by the way. Okay, so, but again, coming back to rationalism. The question of Plato implied the belief of human mind to understand in terms of some mathematical or reasonable principle even such very located events or things which we have no idea about them, but if we will think, we should be able to find the principle. So the belief of the ability of human mind to understand the universe, even very far universe, the belief that our mind in principle is sufficient with efforts, of course, maybe in later generation, but to catch the universe and to understand it, this belief is a core of rationalism, and this belief is already implied by the question of Plato. And then two answers, if again to come back to the planets, two answers to the question of Plato, answer, heliocentric answer of Plato himself, Eudoxus, Aristotle, Callippus, Ptolemy. This is one answer. And another answer actually did exist even time of Plato, when Plato asked this question, but Plato maybe did not know this. It was another system of planetary motion, which was suggested by Pythagorean of third generation Philolaus. And Philolaus suggested not heliocentric system, but system where all the planets and sun rotated around invisible fire, as he called it. So Earth was rotating. And this actually Philolaian system is even older than this Platonic Eudoxus system. And Philolaus was a sort of, is a contemporary of Archytas, the teacher of Plato, Pythagorean teacher of Plato and Eudoxus, or maybe even older thinker. So this is very old actually, but Plato most likely did not know about this. At least we do not see any notion about Philolaus, system of Philolaus, not heliocentric, but all the planets and sun rotated around invisible fire, as they call it, sort of another sun, but invisible. Why did he put there? It's another story, which I just skip for the moment. And then later, this also tracing back to Pythagoreans, this system were improved by Aristarchus from Samos. It is third century before Christ, and Aristarchus suggested what we know as Copernican system. The Copernican system was actually suggested by Aristarchus from Samos, and Copernicus knew, by the way, about this, and in his drafts of his famous book, Aristarchus is mentioned why Aristarchus is not mentioned in the final version of the book of Copernicus, which really was published not by him, but by he was dying at that time when his book was published. But it was published by his student, Reticus, I believe was the name of the student. This I don't know, maybe nobody knows. But in the drafts of Copernicus' book, name of Aristarchus is clearly mentioned. So Copernicus was not inventor of heliocentric system. It was Aristarchus. And Aristarchus actually even calculated the distance to moon and to sun. And he used very correct method to do it, but due to error bars of measurements and high sensitivity of the results to error bars of measurement, he made a mistake factor of 20, which I think is a great success, because it was first measurement, astronomical measurement, distance to moon and to star. And then if you know the distance and you know an angle easily measured, then you know the size of the moon and the sun. So he predicted, Aristarchus predicted the size. So again, all these efforts from the position of Eudoxus, Aristotle, Ptolemy, and another efforts to resolve the same problem on the ground on the same belief, on the unlimited ability of humans to understand even very far objects, to understand essentially entire universe. All these efforts, they converged to different solutions, but they were grounded on the same belief, on the trust to reason, trust to ability of human mind to understand and describe by some beautiful, elegant solution, whatever happens. Actually, Copernicus, why Copernicus followed Aristarchus, not Ptolemy? Because Aristarchus' solution were more elegant mathematically. And he, following again all Pythagorean tradition, believed that it's not, mathematics not only allows us to describe the world, but the true description of world should be mathematically elegant, beautiful, etc. So it should not, if you have to make a choice between some cumbersome and beautiful is not only more convenient, but it is most likely closer to truth, to objective truth. Okay, so this is the core of rationalism. So, but then we may ask a question, how could it be possible that humans realize ourselves in our planet as a sort of very limited creatures with a limited lifespan and limited size, etc. Could it be possible that so limited creatures as humans, also prone to a lot of mistakes, stupidity, etc., all of us, how is it possible that we are able at the same time to understand the universe in its core, not just more or less describe it for our convenience, but to find out the truth about the universe? How is it possible? It is a very strange statement, actually. It is sort of crazy statement. But they all believed in this statement, the ancient rationalists, and the what we see as scientific and technological civilization right now is actually a fruit of this belief, which I sometimes call a trust to reason. Trust to reason at such cosmical scale. It is a very strange religion, if you want, very strange belief. So what was, again, at the core of this belief? The universe has to be globally comprehensible, of course, progressing with effort, not just and they understood everything. Of course, nobody believed like that. But with a lot of efforts, with a lot of generations, humanity is able to progress as far as you may think even further. This is the first point. Then human mind has to be able to increase its global understanding of the world. Value of global cognition has to be high, because these all efforts are very hard. They are possible only if people who are able to do it has very high value of this. So the value should be extremely high, it should be sacrament. This understanding of the world should be the highest sacred thing which human may do. And indeed, in rationalist teaching, we see it. We see it even before the Plato, we see it in Pythagorean schools, we see it in philosophy of Heraclitus, we see it in philosophy of Parmenides. Of course, we see it very powerfully expressed in Plato dialogues, where the whole salvation, the long-term fate of human beings, the long-term life after many metempsychosis. So Plato, as Pythagoreans, also he believed in metempsychosis. So after death, the soul is coming to another body, maybe spending some time on the heavens with gods, or maybe with demons. Actually, actually, Hades was introduced by Plato. It's not a Jewish thing. It is Platonic thing. The Hades.
Hades.
Yes. Okay. So the and this all your fate of your soul after death was strongly associated in your efforts to understand the world. So it was salvation. The teaching of Plato is similar to Pythagorean, actually, was about human life, was a teaching of salvation through cognition. Cognition was the main road to salvation. Salvation in religious sense. Okay, so this is about high value of global cognition. And this global cognitive conformity of limited human mind and the big universe, it's by no means can be considered as something more or less obvious. It's, as I'm trying to stress, it goes against the common sense. It is something very strange and rather unacceptable. But they believed in this strange and unacceptable sense. And why? Why can you accept this very strange belief? Not because you're so proud of man. They ancient rationalists, they knew better than not worse than anybody else that human beings are prone to mistakes and could be very bad in all spheres of life and cognition. But they also took for granted somehow that this conformity, this global conformity between human mind and the objective structure of the universe is provided by the upper level. Upper level responsible both for the universe and for man, which could be called God, but could be called in different ways. Mostly it was this upper level, it was called God. And God, who created the universe, the creator of the universe, and the heavenly father of man in this respect, because he gave man this ability to understand his world, God provided this. How otherwise you can accept this strange idea unless it is already provided and put by this upper level, by the creator, as extremely important and ultimately valuable thing, extremely valuable thing. Okay, so this is the core, a little bit in more details, the core of ancient rationalism. So sometimes describing this core, I am using the term rationalistic triangle. So comprehensible nature, comprehensible universe, then human beings who are able to comprehend the universe without any limits, but of course with efforts, not at once, and then the superpower, which is responsible for entire structure, which created the structure, the upper level, who created this and made the universe comprehensible and gave the man ability to understand. So for the universe, this upper level goes as a super reason, the reason who made the universe reasonable internally. And for the man, this upper level, the God who provided the man this ability, this extreme power to understand God's design, the God goes in this respect as a heavenly father. Because we are able to understand his design. We are able to share his mind, to see what was in his mind, at least with respect to the universe, and even more with respect to man, actually. But this would be a little bit outside of our today's conversation. Okay, so this is rationalistic triangle. Universe, man, God. And these three connected by comprehension, ability to comprehend. Okay, but then the question is, how? By what means man can understand the universe? This also was part of this teaching. Well, okay, so let's assume that I'm hearing some teaching of some rationalist and he told me this, and I said, well, okay, let's assume that I believe you. But by what means I can understand the universe? And then in Plato, we have very powerful teaching about this. And if the teaching about methods, about ways to understand the universe, it is a blend of two things. First, reason, what I would call reason, which requires an additional explanation what it is. And second, beauty, which also requires additional explanation what it is. But setting aside for the moment explanation of reason and beauty, but if combine them together, I may call that the guidance for understanding the universe is a music of reason, whatever it could be. The blending of beauty and reason together, it's music of reason. Music of reason, by the way, I am taking this idiom from a title of book of wants to be a leader of famous mathematical group of French mathematical group Bourbaki, Jean Dieudonné, and there is a book of mathematics is a music of reason. The book was published about 50 years ago or so. It is a wonderful book on the history and philosophy of mathematics, music of reason. And I think that Dieudonné, maybe he invented this term, maybe not, I don't know, but it is very suitable to Platonic teaching of rationalism, music of reason. So about beauty, I'd like to remind you one of my favorite quotation from the symposium. Symposium is one of the famous dialogues of Plato, where Socrates is telling about what is the nature of God, God of love, Erot, or Eros. And in his speech, in his long speech in this symposium, Socrates recollects his discussion with wise lady Diotima, her name was Diotima, who taught young Socrates. So the long-term recollection of Socrates in this symposium. And Diotima taught him about the meaning of beauty. And she ends her teaching to young Socrates with the words, "Beauty is Moira and Eleisa for every genesis." This was the final words of Diotima. What is it? Moira is a goddess of fate in ancient mythology, Greek mythology. And Eleisa is a goddess of midwifing. Eleisa. So, and Genesis is the birth. Is the birth actually, is Greek word which means appearance and birth. So it is beauty which decides what will exist and how these things will exist according to measure of beauty. So beauty is, in this, according to this Diotima words, is the ultimate judge about existence of whatever. Whatever is trying to come to be, it would be beauty. The Greek word is kali. Maybe you can remind me, Donna. No, don't you remember this word, Greek word for beauty, kali.
It's
kaliopa.
Kalone.
Kalone. Kalone.
Well, yeah, it's a form.
Yes, kalone. So it's kalos. It's Greek word for beauty. The beauty gives a fate. What will happen with a thing which tries to appear, maybe will appear, the fate. How specifically this thing will exist. Maybe it will die immediately, because as Eliza, she would not help, and the thing will die, will disappear immediately, because it's not beautiful enough. So the idea is it is up to beauty to decide what will exist, what not. It is a very strong statement. It is a belief on the power of beauty in existence. And mathematics, from its birth, is about beautiful patterns of perfect ideas. That's what actually mathematics is. It's not somebody think who really may have only superficial knowledge of mathematics, and maybe not successful knowledge in school, that mathematics is something about numbers and figures. No, it's very superficial view to mathematics. Mathematics is about beautiful patterns of perfect ideas, what it is. And what that sort of definition, in one or another way, of mathematics you may find in the writings of great mathematicians, actually, who cared to think philosophically about mathematics. So that's what mathematics is. So again, mathematics, which appeared in the Pythagorean schools, it was this. It is musical, it is a music of reason. Mathematics was born, kept, and carried, and developed as a music of reason. And it is a music of reason up to now. This makes a value mathematics, but if something doesn't have value, it wouldn't be developed. That what makes mathematics valuable for mathematicians, not for mathematicians who care how to apply mathematics, like me, for instance, but mathematicians who develop mathematics per se, mathematics for mathematics itself. the only value is beauty of this of these patterns, music of reason, as Jean Dieudonné expressed it. So this is about beauty, and then what about reason? Reason includes many things. So it is hard, critical, and detailed thinking about thinking. So thinking about thinking. It's not thinking about objects, but thinking about thinking. How should we think properly to be able to understand the universe? How should we think? Is our common language, common sense language, our normal Greek language, or whatever language it is it suitable to understand the universe? Most likely not. We have to do something. We have to develop new language, new ways to discuss things, and how this new language should be. At the time of Plato, it was already clear that mathematics is most likely the right way to go, because mathematical ideas were perfect. So if you will say, odd plus odd number is even, is absolute truth without any error bar. Error bar is zero. An absolute truth which valid for whatever reasonable creatures. It's valid by itself. So it is perfect. All mathematical statements are perfect, and they are universally valid. So they belong to objective reason, and objective reason is divine reason. So they belong. Mathematics already, by its nature, belongs to divine mind. So if we will follow mathematical way of thinking, we have a good chance to understand something about the universe. This was a brilliant idea, which actually started by Pythagoreans. And then inherited and enhanced in Platonic schools. All ancient mathematicians were Platonics without any exclusion, including Euclid, including Apollonius, etc. All of them were either mathematicians, or either belonged by themselves to Platonic circles, or had very tight relation to them, like Archimedes, for instance. So thinking about thinking, developing correct language, language of logic and dialectic, how to discuss things, it was a big part of ancient rationalism. So terminology should be established, definitions should be established, axiomatization, classification, including, very interesting thing, classification of mistakes. In Aristotle, we may find classification of mistakes, naming for mistakes. Where, in which philosophy, in which ancient philosophy, we may find also classification of mistakes? I'm not sure about Indian philosophy, maybe in India, in ancient India, maybe, but I don't know. But in China, I don't think that it existed. So this is very deep reflection on language, very careful attitude to developing right ways to think. Even mistakes were classified by Aristotle. So such powerful and interesting methods were developed as method of reductio ad absurdum. This is ancient method, reductio ad absurdum. And mathematical induction, actually, we already find first traces of method mathematical induction. It's a very powerful mathematical method in Parmenides, in the Platonic dialogue Parmenides. And then later it was developed, and later, well, not in ancient period, but in modernity, principle of sufficient reason of Leibniz. What have to be explained, what should not be explained, what should be explained, how we can explain things, what must be explained, principle of sufficient reason. Laws of nature, the very idea of the laws of nature, clearly formulated, their formulation and verification, and critical attitude even to self-evidence, what is self-evident, which was this lesson was fully learned in 20th century already with quantum mechanics, actually. What seemed to be absolutely evident, impossible to doubt, this still were refuted, like particle wave dualism. So electron is at the same time is a local and non-local object. It is local in one respect and non-local in another respect. So this seems sort of a very big challenge to reason. But this big challenge to reason was the fruit of development of reason itself. So reason developing builds and comes to big challenge to itself. And struggling with these challenges. And as a result of these challenges, new ideas are brilliant and interesting ideas to come. So this is what is rationalism, what rationalism is. So let me just read my favorite description of the laws of nature. Laws of nature was a discovery of them. It was the biggest, I think, biggest fruit of rationalism. I think if to name one thing, the most important, what happened with humanity for all its history, I would tell my first choice, my champion is discovery of fundamental laws of nature. This is the biggest and most important thing. By the way, Richard Feynman, when he was asked, what after 1,000 years, what should be considered as the most important event of 19th century? Some wars, some revolutions, some change of dynasties? No. Maxwell equation, discovery of Maxwell equation. This by far the most important event of 19th century. And I agree with him. So that's not to say that I have intention to diminish discoveries of arts or maybe another outside of rationalism philosophical ideas. No, I don't want to diminish them, but I just want to say what to me seems most important and most impressive. So what are the laws of nature? Laws of nature are not, as somebody may have it from his school impression, as some mathematical formulas which describe some physical events. No. First, the laws are endowed with a peculiar mathematical beauty. It's beautiful. It is elegant, symmetrical formulas. Mathematical beauty, uniting in themselves formal simplicity, richness of solution, and one or another kind of symmetry, often as if suggesting itself as a hypothesis to a mind gifted with intuition. Newton wrote his 1 over r squared law and F equal ma after first or maybe maximum after second attempt, almost immediately, because it was simplest way, simplest attempt, simplest hypothesis to describe the world of events, and he succeeded. So it was not so surprising that he tries the simplest. We always try to do this. This is a sort of common sense which they suggested. But surprising that he succeeded to describe all planetary motion by this, by very simple formulas. This is surprising. And this surprise again reveals the deep and strange truth of rationalism, of rationalistic belief. What much later in 20th century, Eugen Wigner, one of the fathers of quantum mechanics, called unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics. Well, for Plato it was very reasonable, because they believe in this rationalistic triangle which I tried to say. And understanding, better and better understanding of the world was an important part of the entire design. That's why the universe is for creatures who have an ability to understand something of the creator will grow and increase their similarity of the creator. This is the entire meaning of the universe for them. So for them, it was not unreasonable at all. It became unreasonable for people who lost this foundation of rationalism, and then, or pretended to lose. I think the Wigner really did not lose, but he called the title of his paper Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics. He sort of played with some of colleagues, we really lost. He did not, as we may read in this very paper. But okay, so the elegance of the laws of nature. Thus, elegance has a decisive significance to a birth of a hypothesis, the most mysterious part of discovery. So elegance, the simplicity and beauty. Secondly, the same elegant mathematical law captures a tremendous range of parameters, distances, time intervals, energies, etc., and that with a fantastic precision, up to 12 digits. Like general relativity, like quantum electrodynamics. This quality of the laws can be called universality and also precision. Finally, the laws happen to be friendly to life, to life's appearing and developing up to intellect. Following the established terminology, this quality can be called anthropic. So the laws are at the same time mathematically elegant, simple, and rich with solution. Self-suggesting, they are universal and they are anthropic and they are precise. So they are very, very special. By no means they may come from somewhere else for an extremely powerful reason. There is no other reasonable answer to this. So laws of nature is a so clear signature of the creator that we cannot even imagine. We just blind to this normally, blinded by the spirit of time. But this blinding power is really strong, of course, because it's able many people to be blinded on that. So the combined presence of these three qualities allowed for their discovery by great minds, and for that reason, it seems that the most appropriate term uniting all three is discoverability. A universe whose law satisfies the discoverability principle of being elegant, universal, and entropic, we suggested to call Pythagorean. So we suggested to call our universe Pythagorean because it is structured by very, very special laws of nature. We live in Pythagorean universe, that's what we claim. It could be even that the laws of our universe constitute the simplest possible set of mathematical structures compatible with the discoverability principle. So were they a little bit more complicated, they would be never discovered. Maybe, I don't know. The only explanation of this amazing quality of the laws is that they come from the highest mind that created our universe, able not only be inhabited by intelligent beings, but cosmically cognized by them. So it is a loop. The Pythagorean universe suggests us a loop. The thinking creatures which appears from scratch and evolving through millennia or many hundred thousand years, eventually grow to the level which they are able to understand, to significant, very significant degree, the laws of their own universe, which allowed them to be there. So this quotation is from the paper which Lev and me wrote, and you may find in our website, pythagoreanuniverse.com, and the paper is called Moira and Eliza for Genesis. So, irrationalist, maybe the last slide and the rest I will tell in the next meeting. Who was against rationalist agenda? Say in the ancient world? There were many philosophical schools who did not share this strange belief, and this is not surprising because belief was really strange. People more so down to earth, more empirical attitude, more skeptical attitude, they looked at this like a dogmatic, strange dogmatic teaching. They did not share. So all sorts of empiricists. So let's step by step, trial and error. Trial and error is the only one reasonable method of studying the nature. This accepts even animals. Even animals following trial and error. So let's accept this well-established method and do not have some fantasies about stars. We cannot check. Okay, you suggested some strange mathematical description of planets. How we can check it and what would be a benefit for us from this? Well, you can describe it. So what? Maybe it's wrong. Maybe it's just illusion, everything. What is the benefit? So empiricists, they were, in this respect, irrationalists because they did not believe in the power of reason. They believe on the touchable things. I can touch, I can taste, okay, I may rely on this. Empiricists, skeptics, up to ultimate skeptics, from moderate skeptics to ultimate skeptics. This is the most powerful contradiction to skepticism, rationalism. Skeptics, even moderate skeptics, did not share this. Cynics did not share this. Epicureans did not share this. Did not share this. So Epicurus, so I would say that all schools, all philosophical schools of what I call narrow horizon of human, teaching of narrow horizon, they did not share this. They opposed to this. And they suggested, of course, their arguments, some reasonable arguments why this belief is very strange and unacceptable to reasonable people like them. So among many schools of ancient thought, we may find atheist or irreligious people, many of them, who also were careless or skeptical about global cognition. They all were skeptical. All atheistic or irreligious group, philosophical groups of ancient world, they were skeptical about global cognition. They didn't believe in that. Like Epicureans, for instance. Theistic irrationalists. Epicurus, by the way, he was irreligious but not atheistic. He did not negate gods. He said that gods do exist, but he did not teach about relations with gods, that God care about us. Epicurean gods did not care about humans. They were they led their happy life, blessed in the heavens or in the distances, in the spaces between worlds, and human life was too dramatic, too hard for gods to pay attention and to be disturbed by this. So for Epicurus, it was even blasphemy to think about gods, that God may care about men. such a poor creature, man, God, sort of enjoying some perfect ideas, or maybe perfect discussions between themselves. So it, we have to, by the way, make a distinction between irreligious teachings like Epicurean and atheistic teaching. Some Greek teachings were atheistic, but some are irreligious, not the same. But all of them were skeptical about global cognition. See, there were also theistic irrationalists who were careless about global cognition of universe too. So you may believe in God, but it doesn't mean that in importance in relation with God, but it doesn't mean that cognition of the global cognition would be valuable for you, not necessarily.
By careless, do you mean they didn't care about it, or they made errors about it?
No, they were careless. It does not matter.
Doesn't matter. Okay.
And theistic rationalists, of course, rationalists. All rationalists of ancient world, they were theistic. In one or another way. Whom we cannot find there in the ancient world, atheistic proponents of global cognition. We cannot find a single thinker in ancient world who both kept importance of global cognition and was atheist or irreligious person. None. And why? Because it would be absolutely absurdic. They do not match. Either one or another. So global cognition could may have value only on theistic ground. However, this strange teaching, which combines atheism with trying to keep value of global cognition, appeared recently when, paradoxically enough, the rationalist agenda proved to be unbelievably fruitful. And this teaching is called scientism sometimes. And we will talk about this next time, so because it's already I already exhausted my time. Now we may discuss what I already told, and I will finish this talk in 2 weeks.
So
thank you so much.
What's next?